This is a follow-on from my video about the men and women being different. And whilst this is not specifically about men and women, I would say it's quite a good follow-on from it. It's certainly where my train of thought has been taking me. We have changed so much in terms of the options and choices that we have to relate to other people, not just the fact that we've got this bizarre tool of the internet and so that we can interact with people the world over, but because of the way the rules have loosened, that we are not obliged or forced to have particular types of relationships, i.e. that we don't have to marry somebody and live with them and be with them all the time. Our options have become so much broader, and I personally think that's a fantastic thing. Many people choose to still have a traditional relationship, and that's a question of their choice. But we have so many more options now. We can go from that place of being with somebody all the time and defining ourselves through them and almost being half a person or find ourselves complete within that person to having a very free interaction where we may be as committed to them, but we do a lot of things on our own. We don't necessarily live with them, we don't necessarily marry them. Quite often I think a freer interaction of that nature can actually bring a greater closeness, a greater understanding, a greater depth. I think it's very easy in the traditional relationship to start taking someone for granted and possibly stop even seeing them or acknowledging them as anything other than an extension of yourself. But that's my personal observation and not there to pass judgment on anybody else. What I'm really saying is that we have many, many options, and that's fantastic. I think the majority of us have a few basic criteria, and call them rules if you like, that make relationship viable for us, that make it work in potential. Some people, for example, can embrace the concept of polyamory or an open relationship. The majority can't. I certainly can't. It just doesn't feel right to me, but that is an option for some people. Ultimately, as long as the person we are in relationship with is comfortable with the way it is and the way we are, then it can work. There has to be a level of commonality in order for it to be successful. But this applies also to friendships. One of the sort of knock-on effects of this change in relationship is that the nature of friendships between people of the same gender, but also people of the opposite sex, has changed. So some people, for example, who are friends and truly are friends, have a sexual component within their relationship, and if that works for those individuals, then that's fine. Some people it doesn't work for. It has to work for both, as it does in relationship. But whether one is in relationship or friendship, and I think the lines between the two are much more blurred than they used to be. There are basic criteria without which neither can work. So I'd just like to present those. we have initially, I would say, honesty. And honesty in itself is kind of fraught in terms of interpretation of what that means, in the same way that the term objectivity clearly does. When I use that word, I don't mean you have to tell that person absolutely everything about you. Besides the fact that that's just an impossibility, there is a place for privacy within any interaction, freedom of choice. But if you are not telling them things that would have an impact on their perception of your interaction, if you're misleading them, misdirecting them, or actively lying to them in any shape or form, that undermines in a very serious way any relationship. Because if you cannot believe what somebody says, it's the crying wolf story, really. Once you get beyond a certain point and you realize that somebody you're interacting with is not telling you their truth or the truth, or elements which might affect your choices about that interaction, there's really nowhere to go. If you can't believe a word somebody says, what have you got? And where do you go from there? So another element, of course, is trust. Not trust to be who you want them to be, trust to behave in the way you would like them to behave necessarily, but trust that they are not going to intentionally mislead you. Trust that they are aware of you and the effects that their actions may have upon you. That there is a level of consideration and appreciation of you. That, of course, is not just about trust, that's about respect. If you don't respect somebody, then the impact of your actions upon them will have little meaning to you. And I think that's another significant element in relating, is that you have to be able to see that there are two people there. You have to own the consequences of your actions. If you see only one set of needs, one set of feelings in an interaction, then you're not actually having an interaction, you are using that person. And if you see only one person, of course, that is fairly soon what you will end up with, or you'll end up with an abusive and dysfunctional relationship. There needs to be a level of openness. Now, all friendships and relationships have a different depth, and so the more superficial relationship, obviously you're going to be telling somebody a whole lot less. But the more comfortable and open an interaction is, the easier it is for the elements of trust and depth and true connection to actually be lived. One final component, which is going to sound very much like a contradiction, but isn't, is that it seems to me the healthiest relationships and friendships have both lack of expectation and freedom written in. That you honour the other person as they are. So, certainly for me, the majority of my most profound friendships and even relationships have moved closer and further apart because there has been no rigid format, no expectation of it being in a certain way. But I will say, on the back of that, without the earlier components that I mentioned of honesty, trust, openness, and respect, you can't have